Good morning all. So today we are going to start our last chapter in the airport engineering. So the air traffic control and the visual aids. First, so the need or purpose of air traffic control. The basic purpose of air traffic control is protection of life and property by avoidance of collision through protective rules and regulation for air traffic. Aircraft must be properly constructed, provided with necessary equipment, and maintained in a good condition. The pilot must be a well-trained and licensed or a certified to undertake flight. The air traffic control deals with that that phase of air transportation which ensures safe and convenient and economical movement of aircraft from one airport to another airport. The aircraft flight from one airport to another involves the following basic action. First, the aircraft takes off from an airport. Second, it maintains a proper altitude in air. It navigates from point to point safely and it lands at the desired airport. But the sabse pehla need suje ke the basic purpose of air traffic control is the protection of life and the property. तुम्हारी लाइफ और प्रॉपर्टी की प्रोटेक्शन माटे बाय अवॉइडेंस ऑफ कोलिजन थ्रू प्रोटेक्टिव रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन फॉर एयर ट्रैफिक एयरक्राफ्ट मस्ट बी प्रॉपरली कंस्ट्रक्टेड प्रोवाइडेड विद नेसेसरी इक्विपमेंट्स एंड मेंटेन इन अ गुड कंडीशंस द पायलट मस्ट बी वेल ट्रेन एंड लाइसेंस और अ सर्टिफाइड टू अंडरटेक फ्लाइट द एयर ट्रैफिक कंट्रोल डील्स विद दैट फेज ऑफ द air transportation which ensures safe, convenient and economical movement of aircraft from one airport to another airport. The total era char actions. First, the aircraft take off from an airport. Aircraft abe airport ki take off hai. Second, it maintains a proper altitude in air. Third, it navigates from one from point to point safely and it lands at the desired airport. Primary function of air traffic control devices. First, air traffic control that deals this deals with to guide the aircraft desiring to land or take off. कि भाई air traffic control का main पहला वो काम सोच है कि भाई तू airport ने guide करवानु from the desiring to land or take off. And second, to control the taxiing of arrival and departing aircraft between the runway and the apron. બરાબર કે જે અરાઇવિંગ અને ડિપાર્ટિંગ એરક્રાફ્ટ છે બરાબર કે જે ટેક ઓફ થઈ રહ્યું છે ઓર જે લેન્ડ થઈ રહ્યું છે બરાબર સો એને ટેક્સી વેમાં અરાઇવલ માટે કંટ્રોલ કરવાનું બિટવીન ધ રનવે એન્ડ એપ્રોન કે એપ્રોનથી નીકળી અને ટેક્સી વેમાં ત્યાં ઊભું રહે છે કે ક્યારે રનવે ઉપર જાય છે કે ક્યારે રનવે ઉપર ઊભું રહી અને ટેક્સી વેમાંથી આવીને અને એપ્રોનમાં પાછું આવે છે સો ફર્સ્ટ ટુ ગાઈડ ધ એરક્રાફ્ટ ડિઝાયરિંગ ટુ લેન્ડ ઓર ટેક ઓફ એન્ડ સેકન્ડ ટુ કંટ્રોલ ધ ટેક્સિંગ ઓફ arriving and departing aircraft between the runway and the apron. Next is a airway traffic control. It deals with the movement of aircraft along the air routes with adequate lateral and the vertical separation to avoid collision. This is particularly needed when visibility is poor. So airway traffic control, it deals with the movement of aircraft along the air routes with adequate lateral and the vertical separation to avoid collision. This is particularly needed when the visibility is poor. કે જ્યારે visibility poor હોય ત્યારે in the mid air બરાબર કે આમાં altitude માં ફેરબદલ કરી દે કરવાનો direction માં કરી દે change કરવાનો to avoid with adequate lateral and vertical separation કે ભઈ lateral as well as vertical separation આઈ મતલબ altitude તમે change કરો direction change કરો to avoid the collision. Next, airway communication. It deals with the conveying of airway and weather information to the pilot during the flights. બરાબર કે એરવે અને વેધર ઇન્ફોર્મેશન તમારા ફ્લાઇટ પાયલટને તમે પ્રોવાઇડ કરો ડ્યુરિંગ ધ ફ્લાઇટ સો એરવે કમ્યુનિકેશન ઇટ ડીલ્સ વિથ ધ કન્વેઇંગ ઓફ એરવે એન્ડ વેધર ઇન્ફોર્મેશન ટુ ધ પાયલટ ડ્યુરિંગ ધ ફ્લાઇટ નોન એરવે ટ્રાફિક કંટ્રોલ દિસ પ્રેઝન્ટ અ સિરિયસ પ્રોબ્લેમ એન્ડ ધ પર્સનલ ફ્લાઇંગ ઇઝ ડન બાય અ લાર્જ નંબર ઓફ પીપલ Such type of flying must be regulated to prevent interference to the main air traffic. બરાબર સો નોન એરવે ટ્રાફિક કંટ્રોલ એટલે કે જ્યારે કોઈ બી પર્સનલ પીપલ પોતાનો ફ્લાઇંગ એક્ટિવિટીઝ કન્ડક્ટ કરતા હોય દિસ પ્રેઝન્ટ અ સિરિયસ પ્રોબ્લેમ when personal flying is done by a large number of people. Such type of flying must be regulated to prevent interference to the main air traffic, various purposes of air traffic control. The main purpose of air traffic control are safety, efficiency and economy. So first is the safety, providing guidance to the pilot where vision may be obstructed during the landing and takeoff. Pilot ne guidance provide karvano ke jare vision may be obstructed during landing and takeoff. Providing separation and the right of way guidance to arriving and departing aircraft when visibility is poor. Separation and right of way guidance to arriving and departing aircrafts when visibility is poor. So ICAO has classified visibility into three categories. Category first, forward visibility at least 800 meter. Category two, forward visibility of 400 meter. And category three, for zero visibility condition. The three conditions are that if you have 800 meter ki wadhar jo dekha jaye visibility, so that falls into the category one. So category two, forward visibility of 400 meter. And category three, zero visibility conditions. Next is efficiency. Proper air traffic control helps in speedy movement of traffic. Timetables and schedules of flights are maintained with the reasonable limits and avoiding delays and avoiding waste of time so that the airports are not waiting for business and spaces in airway. In airway is not idle. Facility are thus effectively used. But the speedy movement of traffic, timetables and schedule of flight are maintained with the reasonable limits, avoiding delays and avoiding waste of time so that the airports are not waiting for business and space. Airway is not ideal. Facilities are thus effectively used. Last is the economy. Delay causes loss. Air traffic control is designed to avoid delay as far as possible. Ideal planes, airports not used to capacity and airway not carrying the traffic of they are capable represent wasted investment. Bravo. So economy le tumhe koi bhi jo delay tha, so that is cause the losses. So air traffic control is designed to avoid delay as far as possible. Ideal planes, airport not used to capacity and airways not carrying the traffic of they are capable represent wasted investment. Ke jo bhai plane je che ane airport che barabar e je ane full capacity par use na thai jata, so that is called the wasted or wasted investment. Next is a flight rule. There are the two types of flight rules of air traffic determined by the weather condition. First is a visual flight rules and second is a instrumental flight rules. First is a visual flight rules, VFR. VFR may be described as a clear weather flying when the weather condition are such that the aircraft can maintain safe separation by visual means by the pilot themselves. Under VFR condition, there is a very little of air traffic control. Air control monitor intervenes only when apparent conflicts develop between aircraft. Visual flight rules એટલે કે VFR may be described as a clear weather flying. બરાબર, કે clear weather હોય એ વખતે તમે એને ફ્લાય કરો કે જે વખતે તમારે કોઈ બી ટાઈપના ઇન્સ્ટ્રુમેન્ટલ ઓર ગાઈડન્સની જરૂર ના પડે. When the weather condition are such that the aircraft can maintain safe separation by visual means by the pilot themselves. Under VFR condition, there is a very little of air traffic control. Air control monitor intervenes only when apparent conflicts develop between the aircraft. Next is the instrumental flight rules. IFR may be described as a bad weather or blind flying when visibility is poor or the height of the clouds fall below the visual meteorological condition. In IFR condition, air traffic control personnel guide the safe separation between the aircraft. So IFR, instrumental flight rules may be described as a bad weather. કે જે જગ્યાએ તમારી visibility poor હોય અને જે તમારું cloud છે, so the cloud falls below the visual meteorological condition. In IFR condition, air traffic control personnel guide the safe separation between the aircraft to avoid the possibility of mid air collision at high speed and density of traffic. The IFR are prescribed regardless of the weather condition. This is called the positive control airspace, which is used where high speed jet operators at airport radar service areas as well as the airspace as at above 6000 meter above mean sea level, in which jet fly from one point airport to the another en route to avoid the possibility of mid air collision at a high speed and density of traffic. IFR are prescribed regardless of the weather condition. This is called the positive control airspace. બરાબર, કે કોઈ જગ્યાએ જો તમારી visibility ભી સારી હોય પણ જે જગ્યાએ તમારું speedy movement થતું હોય અને તમારે traffic density બહુ જ વધારે હોય તો એ વખતે IFR prescribe કરવામાં આવે છે. So that is called the positive control airspace, which is used where the high speed High speed jet operate at airport radar service area as well as the airspace at about 6000 meter above mean sea level in which jet fly from one airport to the another en route. Air traffic control network. The network for controlling the air traffic can be divided into the three parts as follows. First is a control within terminal area, control over airways and airway communication. But the first is a control within terminal area. This is done from the airport control tower, which is located in the terminal area. The control tower is now center of an area. બરાબર કે તમારું જે એરપોર્ટ કંટ્રોલ ટાવર છે તમારા એરપોર્ટની અંદર નજીક બનેલું હોય કે એરપોર્ટની અંદર વિકિનિટીમાં જ બનેલું હોય સો લોકેટેડ ઇન ધ ટર્મિનલ ધ કંટ્રોલ ટાવર ઇઝ અ નર્વ સેન્ટર ઓફ એન એરિયા ઇટ ઇઝ અ મોસ્ટ ક્રુશિયલ એન્ડ મોસ્ટ ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ સેન્ટર ઓફ એની એરપોર્ટ ધ એરપોર્ટ ટ્રાફિક કંટ્રોલ ટાવર ETCT is the facility which supervise, direct and monitors the arrival and the departure of aircraft at the airport and in the airspace within about 8 kilometers from the airport. Air traffic control tower jaise barabar is surveillance, guidance and monitors, directs and monitors provide kare che the arrivals and the departure of the aircraft at the airport and in the airspace within about 8 kilometers of from the airport બરાબર કે 8 કિલોમીટર ની વિકિનિટી ની અંદર જેટલા બી એરક્રાફ્ટ હશે તો એ લોકોને એ ગાઈડન્સ ને બધું પ્રોવાઈડ કરે છે ઇટ પ્રોવાઇડ્સ ફોલોઇંગ બેઝિક સર્વિસ ઇશ્યુ ટ્રાફિક કંટ્રોલ ઇન્સ્ટ્રક્શન એન્ડ ઇન્ફોર્મેશન ટુ ધ એરક્રાફ્ટ ટેકિંગ ઓફ લેન્ડિંગ એન્ડ અપ્રોચિંગ ફોર લેન્ડિંગ issue traffic control instruction and information by the traffic control instruction and information provided to aircraft taking off landing and approaching for landing issue instruction to aircraft taxiing for the purpose of preventing collision between the aircraft on the landing area and the vehicular traffic on the landing area issue advice to pilot of aircraft when meteorological condition which may not be known to the pilot issue special instruction to the pilot concerning emergency landing areas obstruction landmark regulation etc start and plan crash and emergency procedures when an emergency occurs or in the vicinity of the landing area an airport control tower must be so located that it will be provide an unobstructed view of all runways taxiway and approaches to the airport The usual practice at civil airport is to place the control tower structures on the top of the highest building, usually the administration building. So, following basic service, we provide issue traffic control instruction and information. બરાબર છે ઇશ્યુ ઇન્સ્ટ્રક્શન ટુ ધ એરક્રાફ્ટ ટેક્સિંગ ફોર ધ પર્પઝ ઓફ પ્રિવેન્ટિંગ કોલિઝન બિટવીન ધ એરક્રાફ્ટ ઓન લેન્ડિંગ એરિયા એન્ડ ધ વિહિક્યુલર ટ્રાફિક ઓન ધ લેન્ડિંગ એરિયા ઇશ્યુ એડવાઇઝ ટુ પાયલટ ઓફ એરક્રાફ્ટ વેન ધ મેટ્રોલોજીકલ કન્ડિશન વિચ મે નોટ બી નોન ટુ ધ પાયલટ issue special instruction to pilots concerning emergency landing areas obstruction landmarks regulations and the start and plan crash and emergency procedures when an emergency occurs on or in the vicinity of the landing area an airport control tower must be so located that it will provide an unobstructed view of all runways taxiways and the approaches to the airport the usual practice at the civil airport is to place the control tower structures on the top of the highest building usually the administration building second is a control over airways air road traffic control centers control the movement of an route aircraft along the airway jet route and in other parts of the airspace each ARTCC control a certain defined geographical area thus covering the entire area of the country These centers are usually located at the major airports so as to eliminate the expense of additional communication facility. In India, ARTCC are provided at Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata, Nagpur, Ahmedabad, Allahabad, Delhi and Jodhpur. At the boundary point of one control area center, control of the aircraft may be transferred to the adjacent center or to control tower of the airport as they call case may be. ARTCC is mainly concerned with the flight under IFR conditions. The pilot first gives his flight plan to ARTCC, who then decide the altitude at which the aircraft may fly so as to ensure a safe separation from other aircraft operating along the same airway. Without radar coverage, aircraft are separated by a distance equivalent to 10 minutes run when flying on the same altitude. If radar facility available, the minimum separation is 8 kilometers. So control over airways so air route traffic control centers barabar is a main center which covers the entire nation or entire country airspace અમુક જગ્યાએ મેજર એરપોર્ટની જગ્યાએ હોય કે જે જગ્યાએથી તમને ટોટલ ઓવરઓલ સર્વેલન્સ તમને મળી શકે. These centers are usually located at the major airports so as to eliminate the expense of additional communication facilities. In India, ARTCC are provided at the Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata, Nagpur, Ahmedabad, Allahabad, Delhi and Jodhpur. Now, airway communication, this is mainly done through flight service station. These stations are located at the airport and also along the airways. Their functions are to give a certain information to the pilots before and during flights regarding the weather changes, navigational aids, airport that are out of use and the procedures at a particular airport, to relay air traffic control messages between the ARTCC and en route aircraft. Whatever. So airway communication, this is mainly done through the flight service station. This situation are located at the airport and also along the airways. Their functions are to give the certain information to the pilots before and during the flight regarding the weather change, navigational aid, airport that are out of use, and the procedures at the particular airport, to relay air traffic control message between the ARTCC and en route aircraft. Air traffic control aids. During the VFR condition, visual flight rule weather condition, the flight is usually conducted by visual recognition of the objects on the ground. IFR used when the visibility is poor during nighttime or due to the cloudy or the foggy weather. During all visibility conditions, the following air traffic control aids are always available to the pilot during the flight. First is en route aids or airway aids, and the second is a landing aids. So first is en route aids. The following aids are available to the pilots during his flight from one airport to another. First is an airway beacon. Airway beacon, low medium frequency radio range, very high frequency omnidirectional range, tactical air navigation, distance measuring equipment, air route surveillance radar, marker beacon, and the direction finder. First is an airway beacon. In the past, airway beacon lights were the only means of air navigation. They were spaced about 40 km apart along the air route to guide the pilot from one airport to another. These are now considered as obstacles and are replaced with a more effective control. However, few beacons still exist in the key position, hill peak points. So airway beacon, in the past, airway beacon lights are lights were the only means of air navigation. Khali ekaj type of air navigation system available. They were spaced about 40 kilometers apart along the air route. એરપોર્ટ થી 40 કિલોમીટર ની દૂર એવી રીતે મૂકેલી હોય અલોંગ ધ એર રૂટ ટુ ગાઈડ ધ પાયલટ ફ્રોમ વન એરપોર્ટ ટુ અનધર. ધીસ આર નાવ કન્સિડર્ડ એઝ ઓબ્સ્ટેકલ એન્ડ આર રિપ્લેસ્ડ વિથ મોર ઇફેક્ટિવ કંટ્રોલ. હાઉએવર, ફ્યુ બેકન્સ સ્ટીલ એક્ઝિસ્ટ ઇન અ કી પોઝિશન, હિલ પીક પોઈન્ટ્સ. Low medium frequency radio range. The low medium frequency radio range was invented in the early 30s and it revolutionized the navigational aid. The four course radio ranges sends out four radio beams along four directional, which may or may not be at the right angles to each other. This facility may be located near the airport, and if a pilot is able to pick up a steady drone, it indicates the correctness of the air route followed by him. If, however, the pilot is not the correct route, he will be hear a dot dash dot dash dot signal and he can adjust his position accordingly. બરાબર. સો લો મીડિયમ ફ્રિકવન્સી રેડિયો રેન્જ એટલે કે ભાઈ તમારી જે ફ્રિકવન્સી છે બરાબર, એ જે કોઈ એક સ્ટેશન છે ત્યાંથી ફોર ડિરેક્શનમાં એની બીમ્સ પાસ થશે બરાબર, અને એમાંથી જે બી પાયલટ છે એ તમારી જે રેન્જ છે ફ્રિકવન્સી રેન્જ એ કલેક્ટ કરશે. ઇફ જો એને ક્લિયર રેન્જ સંભળાતી હશે બરાબર, સો દેટ ઇઝ મીન કે એ પ્રોપર એના પ્રોપર પોઝિશન ઉપર જતો હશે બરાબર, કે પ્રોપર એનું જે લેટિટ્યુડ છે, લોંગિટ્યુડ અને લેટરલ્સ જે છે બરાબર, લેટરલ ડિરેક્શન્સ, સો એ પ્રોપર હશે. પણ જો ઇફ એને ડોટ ડેશ ઓર ડેશ ડોટ સિગ્નલ્સ મળતા હશે તો જો એને રૂટને મોડિફાઈ કરી અને કરેક્ટ રૂટ ઉપર એને જવું પડશે. વેરી હાઈ ફ્રિકવન્સી ઓમની ડિરેક્શનલ રેન્જ. ધે સ્ટેશન્સ આર લોકેટેડ ઓન ધ ગ્રાઉન્ડ એન્ડ સેન્ડ્સ રેડિયો સિગ્નલ ઇન ઓલ ડિરેક્શન વિચ કેન બી ફોલોડ બાય એન એરક્રાફ્ટ. ધીસ આર 360 રેડિયલ કોર્સિસ ઓર routes at one interval from a VOR station from 0 degree pointing towards magnetic north, increasing to 359 degree in a clockwise direction. VOR station is a small square building. Its broadcast frequency is just above FM radio station. A system of VOR station establishes the network of airways and jet routes. Aircraft is equipped with the VOR receivers in the cockpit, which can be turned to the desired VOR frequency. A pilot can choose the route to follow to the VOR station. A position deviation indicator in the cockpit specifies the position of the aircraft relative to the direction of the desired radial and whether aircraft is to the left or right of the radial route. Tactical air navigation. This was developed by the US Navy for satisfying the tactical needs of the military force. It measured the azimuth and the distance in one unit instead of two. It is operated in the ultra high frequency band. The next is a distance measuring equipment. This equipment has been installed at nearly all the VOR station. It indicates to the pilot that the air distance between the aircraft and the particular VOR station. The pilot thus get a precise idea of his position with respect to the airway. Air route surveillance radar. The word radar stands for the radio detection and ranging. A sharp pulse of a radio frequency energy is sent out by the transmitter and repeated a number of times per second. The object to be detected receives the waves and scattered and reflects part of them. The echo travel back to the site of transmission and it is detected by the radar as a signal coming from the target. The time taken for the pulse to leave the antenna and travel back as an echo indicates the distance at which the target is located. Thus, the SAT operate as a transmitter and receiver both. Long-range radars for tracking and en route aircraft is used. This radar provides an air traffic controller with a visual display of the position of each aircraft so they can monitor the spacing and intervene if necessary in some situation. The radar is used for guiding the aircraft and thus provides an aid to the air navigation. Long-range radar for tracking an entire aircraft is used. This radar provides an air traffic controller with a visual display of the position of each aircraft so they can monitor the spacing and intervene if necessary in some situation. The radar is used for guiding the aircraft and thus provide an aid to the air navigation. Next is a marker beacon. The small radio transmitter known as the marker beacon are helpful to the pilot for determining his position on a given airway. They send a coded radio signal which the pilot is able to identify. There is a cone of silence just above the tower of the radio range station. It is in the form of an intervene cone with a limited area. As the aircraft enter the cone, the signal abruptly fade out and they remain blank for a few seconds until the aircraft is in the cone area. They once again start as soon as the aircraft leave from the other side of the cone. The duration of marker indicate increase with the increase in the flight altitude. The cone of silence does not always provide a reliable information. They have been replaced by the Z-type markers, which are more effective and precise. They are installed at almost all the radio range stations. As the aircraft passes over the Z marker, there is a visual indication in the cockpit, which attains a maximum brilliance directly over the station. The marker beacon no apne aa rite use thai ke ek type of ek zone of silence create kare ke je jagah hai jare koi bhi aircraft yani upar pass karta hoy to tumhara je radio signals che it abruptly change thai or fade out thai so that indicate that ke tumhara a particular marker beacon upar thi tumharu aircraft pass thayu che bara pan je marker beacon je cone shape hatu so that is not provide a reliable solution or reliable information all the time. So the Z type markers are replaced and it provides a effective and the precise information of the aircraft. Direction finder. There are two types of the direction finder. First is a radio direction finder and second is a automatic direction finder. So radio direction finder and automatic direction finder. In RDF, the pilot rotate the radio aid installed in the aircraft till from a particular direction he receive a high pitch tone which indicate that the receiver is now pointing towards the direction of the station. A blank occurs when the RDF is directed at the right angle to the direction along which the transmitter is located. ADF is more sophisticated instrument. It keeps the antenna automatically pointing towards the source of transmission and require no adjustment. Next is a landing aid. The following aids are available to any aircraft at the time of landing. First is an instrument landing system. Second is a precision approach radar. Third is an airport surveillance radar. Fourth is an airport surface detection equipment. And fifth is an approach lighting system. First is an instrument landing system, ILS. ILS is the most commonly used system. It consists of the two radio transmitters located at the airport. One radio beam is called the localizer and the other is called the glide slope. The localizer indicates the pilot whether he is toward the left or right of the correct position of the approach to the runway. So localizer, the localizer is located on the extension of a runway center line at a distance about 300 meters from the far end of a runway. The localizer sends radio beam signal in vertical plane and indicate to the pilot whether he is left or right of the correct alignment for approach to the runway. Glide slope, it transmits radio beams in a horizontal plane and indicate to the pilot the correct angle of the descent to the runway. It is situated at a distance of 125 meter to 375 meter down the runway from the threshold and to one side of the runway center line at a distance varying from 120 meter to 195 meter. Well, so aap humne jo figure humne dikhai rahe hain, so that is called the localizer antenna, and second is a guiding slope. બરાબર કે તમારી જે ગાઈડિંગ સ્લોપ છે બરાબર એ આ રીતનું આખું એક તમને ગાઈડ પ્રોવાઈડ કરે, ગાઈડ પાથ પ્રોવાઈડ કરે કે જેથી તમારે કયા એંગલ ઉપર એને ચેન્જ થઈ અને તમારે મૂવ થવાનું છે. અને લોકલાઇઝર એન્ટેના એ તમારું એક વિઝ્યુઅલ એડ્સ જે છે બરાબર એ પ્રોવાઈડ કરે કે જેથી તમારે ખબર પડે કે વેધર યુ આર ઇન ધ રાઈટ પોઝિશન ઓફ સેન્ટર લાઈન બરાબર, કે તમારું જે હાઈવે સેન્ટર લાઈન જે છે બરાબર, સોરી રનવે સેન્ટર લાઈન બરાબર, એના લેફ્ટ પોર્શનમાં છો કે રાઈટ પોર્શનમાં છો બરાબર. સો એ તમને અહીંયાથી એક સીધી બીમ કેરી કરે કે જેથી તમારા જે પાયલટ્સ જે અહીંયા આવી રહ્યું છે બરાબર, એને ખબર પડે કે ભાઈ એ પ્રોપર લેફ્ટ પોર્શનમાં છે ઓઈધર રાઈટ પોર્શનમાં છે. Further help the pilot on his ILS approach, two low proper fan marker called ILS marker are installed so that the pilot will know how far along the approach to the runway they have progressed. Outer marker, it is located at a distance of about 7 km from the end of the runway. It gives a purple light on the instrument panel in the cockpit of the aircraft. A middle marker, it is located at a distance of about 1 km from the end of a runway. It gives an amber light on the instrument panel in the cockpit of the aircraft. ILS thus provide landing facility even when weather condition and visibility is poor. However, it has the following limitations. So any limitations would be the first, the functioning of a localizer and glide slope antenna is affected by the close proximity of moving objects such as a vehicle and the aircraft traffic. Stationary object nearby can also cause a deterioration of the signal. Abrupt changes of slope in the proximity to the antennas are not permitted, or else signal will not be transmitted properly. The glide slope beam is not reliable below a height of about 65 meter above the runway. The ILS provides only one path in space, which all aircraft must follow if they are using the system. બરાબર કે ભાઈ લિમિટેશન ફંક્શનિંગ ઓફ લોકલાઇઝર એન્ડ ધ ગ્લાઇડ સ્લોપ એન્ટેના ઇઝ અફેક્ટેડ બાય ધ ક્લોઝ પ્રોક્સિમિટી ઓફ અ મૂવિંગ ઓબ્જેક્ટ સચ એઝ અ વ્હીક્યુલર એન્ડ ધ એરક્રાફ્ટ ટ્રાફિક. સ્ટેશનરી ઓબ્જેક્ટ્સ નિયર બાય કેન ઓલ્સો કોઝ અ ડિટેરિએશન ઓફ ધ સિગ્નલ. Abrupt changes of slope in the proximity to the antennas are not permitted, or else signals will not be transmitted properly. The glide slope beam is not reliable below a height of about 65 meter above the runway. The ILS provides only one path in space, which all aircraft must follow if they are using the system. Second is a precision approach radar. The precision approach radar was developed by the military people during the World War II. To provide a mobile unit that is not dependent on the airborne navigational equipment. PAR system gives the controller a picture of a descending aircraft both in plan and elevation. The controller can determine whether an aircraft is on the glide path or whether it is on the correct alignment. Instruction from the controller to the pilot are given by the voice communication, and therefore no airborne equipment is necessary. Commercial aircraft generally use ILS because PAR places too much dependence on the controller at the airport where both ILS and PAR are provided. Commercial pilots use ILS but often request that they be monitored simultaneously by the PAR. Next is the airport surveillance radar. ASR is installed at the major airports to provide the control tower operator with an overall picture of what is going on within the airspace surrounding the terminal. ASR rotates through 360 degree and the picture is received on the radar scope in the control tower. The range of ASR is from 50 km to 100 km. It shows the aircraft in that relative position on the radar scope as dips. ASR does not indicate the altitude of an aircraft. Next is a visual aid. The pilot is guided by the visual aid during the landing and taking off operation in day and night in all weather conditions. Runway threshold, runway edges, and the runway centerline are the most essential item which should be clearly visible to the pilot in order to enhance the daytime visibility. Runway, taxiway, and other allied structures are marked with line and numbers. In the daytime during the poor weather condition or at night, the visibility reduced considerably. It is essential to provide adequate lighting in the airport, which would convey the similar information to the pilot as the marking do in the daytime. The different types of visual aid for air navigation can be classified as: first is an indicator, second is a marking, third is a lighting, fourth is a sign, and fifth is a marker. So first is an indicator, wind direction indicator or wind cone. Wind cone is provided at an airport to indicate the direction of wind. It is placed with a segmented circle marker together with the lagging direction indicator as shown in the figure. As per the ICAO, the segmented circle should have an inside diameter of 30 meter and panel width varying from 0.9 meter to 2.40 meter. આ ટાઈપનું જે છે એ ટાઈપનું આખું એક એનું વિન્ડ ડિરેક્શન ઇન્ડિકેટર હોય. ધ વિન્ડ ડિરેક્શન ઇન્ડિકેટર શુડ બી ઇન ધ ફોર્મ ઓફ ટ્રુન્કેટેડ કોન મેડ ઓફ ફેબ્રિક. ICAO રિકમેન્ડ દેટ ઇટ્સ લેન્થ શુડ નોટ બી લેસ દેન 3.6 મીટર એન્ડ ધ ડાયમીટર એટ ધ લાર્જર એન્ડ શુડ નોટ બી લેસ દેન 0.9 મીટર. ઇટ શુડ બી સો કલર્ડ that it is visible from a height of 300 meters. To achieve a better color contrast with respect to its background, it may be painted with bands of two different colors like red or white or orange and white. The wind direction indicator must be placed at a distance place away from the building so that it is not affected by the eddies. Second is a landing direction indicator. The landing direction indicator is in the form of T. It should be located in the conspicuous place of the airport. The purpose of the landing direction indicator is to indicate to the pilot the direction of active runway of the airport. The shape and the minimum dimension of the landing T should be as shown in the figure. The color of the landing T shall be either white or orange. The quick landing direction indicator, where required for the use at the night landing, T shall either be illuminated or outlined by the white lights. Next is the airport marking. Airport marking helps the pilot in proper, efficient, and safe use of the airport facility. The airport area is marked in a simple manner so that the pilot can easily spot and recognize to the various airport elements. First is a runway marking, second is a taxiway marking, third is a apron marking, fourth is a shoulder marking, and the fifth is a other marking. So first is a runway marking. Following marking are used on the runway. First is a runway designation marking. Second is runway centerline marking, runway threshold marking, runway touchdown zone marking, runway aiming point marking, and runway side strip marking. First is a runway designation marking. A runway designation marking identifies a runway by its magnetic azimuth. They are located at the threshold of the paved runway as shown in the figure. Example 5, runway designation, centerline, and the threshold marking. આ તમારું જે દેખાઈ રહ્યું છે દેટ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ ધ રનવે સેન્ટરલાઇન માર્કિંગ. ઇટ ઇઝ અ રનવે થ્રેશોલ્ડ માર્કિંગ. The runway designation markings are in white color. A runway designation marking consists of a numbers on a parallel runway. The number is supplemented with a letter like L, C, and R. તમે આજે દેખાઈ રહ્યું છે લેફ્ટ રાઇટ, આજે તમને એલ દેખાઈ રહ્યું છે, 20 દેખાઈ રહ્યું છે, સો દેટ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ અ રનવે ડેઝિગ્નેશન. બરાબર, આ જે તમારી જે લાઇન દેખાઈ રહી છે, સો દેટ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ અ રનવે સેન્ટર લાઇન, અને આ જે પટ્ટીઓ દેખાઈ રહી છે, સો દેટ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ અ રનવે થ્રેશોલ્ડ. ફોર એક્ઝામ્પલ, ફોર અ સિંગલ રનવે વેર ધ મેગ્નેટિક અઝ્યુમિથ ઇઝ 20 ડિગ્રીઝ, ધ રનવે ડેઝિગ્નેશન માર્કિંગ વુડ બી 20. ઇન કેસ ઓફ ધ પેરેલલ રનવે, દે આર માર્ક એઝ અ ફોલો એટ ધ થ્રેશોલ્ડ. For two parallel runway having a magnetic azimuth of 182 degree, the runway would be designated as 18L or 18R. For three parallel runway having the magnetic azimuth of 87, the runway would be designated as 9L, 9C, 9R. For four parallel runway having magnetic azimuth of 265 degree, the runway would be designated as 26L, 26R, 27L and 27R. Next is a runway centerline marking. Runway centerline marking identifies the physical center line of the runway and provides alignment guidance during the landing and the takeoff operation. It is located along the centerline of the runway. Runway centerline markings are white in color as shown in the figure. A runway centerline marking shall consist of a line of uniformity spaced strips and gaps. The length of each strip is 36 meter and gaps are 24 meter in length. The minimum width of strip is 0.90 meter for precision approach category 2 and 3 runways and 0.45 meter for non-precision approach runway. Next is a runway threshold marking. A threshold marking identifies the beginning of the runway that is available for landing. The strips of the threshold marking start 6 meters from the runway threshold. They are white in color. The minimum length of the strip is 30 meters. The length of strip shall be in accordance with the runway width as follows. So if the runway width is 18 meters, number of strip 4. So if the runway width is 60 meters, so the number of strip is 16. Runway touchdown zone marking. Runway touchdown zone marking identify the touchdown zone for landing operation and are coded to provide distance information. The color of touchdown zone marking is white. તમને આજે દેખાઈ રહ્યું છે ટચડાઉન ઝોન માર્કિંગ, સો દેટ ઇઝ ઇન ધ વ્હાઇટ પોઝિશન. ફોર પેટર્ન શો ઇન ધ ફિગર, ધ માર્કિંગ શેલ નોટ બી લેસ ધેન 22.5 મીટર લોંગ એન્ડ 3 મીટર વાઇડ. ફોર પેટર્ન શો ઇન ધ ફિગર, ધ માર્કિંગ શેલ નોટ બી શેલ બી નોટ શેલ બી નોટ લેસ ધેન 22.5 meter long and 1.8 meter wide with a spacing of 1.5 meter between adjacent strip. The pairs of the marking shall be provided at the longitudinal spacing of 150 meter beginning from the threshold. Next is a runway aiming point marking. તમને આજે દેખાઈ રહ્યું છે dark, બરાબર, so that is called the runway aiming point marking. The aiming point marking serve as a visual aiming point for landing operation. The beginning of the aiming point marking commence 400 meter from threshold. Aiming point marking are in white in color. An aiming point marking consists of the two rectangular marking 45 meter in length located symmetrically on each side of the runway centerline as shown in the figure. The width of each marking is 10 meter for a runway width of 45 meter or a greater. The next is a runway centerline side strip marking. Runway side strip provide a visual contrast between the runway and the surrounding terrain and delineate the width of the paved area that is intended to be used as a runway. Runway side strip consists of continuous strips located on each side of the runway. The maximum distance between the outer edge of the strip is 60 meter. Runway side strip marking are white in color. A runway side strip should have an overall width of at least 0.9 meter on a runway, 30 meter or more in width, and at least 0.45 meter on a narrower runway. Next is a taxiway marking. All the taxiways should have a centerline markings and runway holding position markings whether they intersect a runway. All the taxiway markings are yellow in color. Following are the markings used on the taxiway. Taxiway centerline marking, taxiway edge marking, high holding position markings on the taxiway, and the taxiway shoulder marking. सो आ तमने जे फिगर देखाई रही छे सो બધી આખી ફિગરમાં બધી જ માર્કિંગ આવી ગયા ટેક્સીવે માર્કિંગ થ્રેશોલ્ડ માર્કિંગ ટેક્સીવે ડેઝિગ્નેશન ટેક્સીવે હોલ્ડિંગ લાઇન સેન્ટર લાઇન ઓફ અ ટેક્સીવે બરાબર રનવે છે બધી સેન્ટર લાઇન ઓફ ટેક્સીવે રનવે હોલ્ડિંગ લાઇન ઓફ ટેક્સીવે The center line of a taxi way is marked with an angle with a single strip having a 50 centimeter width. This center line normally terminates at the runway edge, except in the case of exit taxiway, where the taxiway center line is curved into the center line of a runway. At taxiway intersection, the marking of the taxiway center line continues through the intersection areas as shown in the figure. A holding point marker should be painted at all the intersection of the paved taxiway with a runway. The holding position should be at least 30 meters from the edge of the runway as shown in the figure. Next is a apron marking. The apron is provided with a certain guidelines which will help the pilots in the maneuvering the aircraft on the apron. The marking is done with a yellow paint. Usually the guideline is painted to indicate the path of the nose gear of the most critical aircraft. The smaller aircraft can also use the same path and maneuver without difficulty. The next is shoulder marking. Runway shoulder marking are used when needed as a supplemented to runway side strip to identify pavement areas continue to the runway side that are not intended for use by the aircraft. Runway shoulder markings are located between the runway side strip and the pavement edges as shown in the figure. The color of runway shoulder marking should be yellow. Runway shoulder marking consists of strips 1 meter width, space 30 meter apart. The strips are slanted at 45 degree to the runway center line. So next is the taxiway shoulder marking. The taxiway shoulder marking are in yellow color. It consists of 1 meter wide strips at spacing 30 meter and a perpendicular to the center line of the taxiway. The strips are extended to 1.5 meter from the edge of the stabilized area. Runway shoulder, ballast pad, runway, holding apron and the taxiway. Other marking. The first is a chevron. Chevron are used to identify the pavement areas unusable for landing, takeoff and taxiing. Chevrons are located on the pavement areas that are aligned with and continuous to the runway as shown in the figure. They are yellow in the color. Okay, aap mujhe dikhai rahe ho. કે એવા એરિયા કે જે આપણે લેન્ડિંગ માટે ટેકઓફ માટે અને ટેક્સી માટે યુઝ નથી થતા બરાબર સો દેટ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ ધ શેવરોન્સ લાસ્ટ આપણો ટોપિક છે એરપોર્ટ લાઇટિંગ ડ્યુરિંગ નાઇટ ટાઈમ એન્ડ અંડર રિસ્ટ્રિક્ટેડ વિઝિબિલિટી ધ પાયલટ ઇઝ એડેડ બાય મીન્સ ઓફ અ સિસ્ટમ્સ ઓફ અ સિગ્નલ During night time and under restricted visibility, the pilot is aided by means of a system of a signal light, which convey to him a certain information by color, arrangement, and other necessary characteristics. This information is necessary to make a safe landing and takeoff and also guide him to any required position of the airfield. Example, to and from the apron, the color and the general pattern are standardized for all airports to prevent confusion to the pilot. Airport lighting can be divided into the following elements. First is an airport beacon. Second is an identification beacon. Third is an approach lighting. Fourth is a circle guidance lighting. Fifth is a threshold lighting. Sixth is a runway lighting. Seven is a taxiway lighting. Eight is a apron hangar lighting. Nine, stopway lighting. Wind direction indicator lighting. Landing direction indicator lighting. First is an airport beacon. It indicates to pilot that the field is equipped for the night operation. It should be mounted at least 6 meters above any adjacent building, but as near to the airport as possible without any obstruction to the flying. The beacon is rotated at a 6 revolutions per minute. It projects beam of light into two horizontal direction, 180 degree apart. One beam should flash under a clear light and other green light. For marine airport, only yellow light is used. So airport beacon, it indicates to pilot that the field is equipped for the night operation. It should be mounted at least 6 meters above any adjacent building, but as near to the airport as possible without any obstruction to the Nine. The beacon is rotated at the 6 revolution per minute. It projects beams of a light into horizontal direction, 180 degree apart. One beam should be flash a clear light and other green light. For Marine Airport, only yellow light is used. Second is identification beacon. The identification beacon, also known as a core beacon, is provided at airport, which is intended for use at night and cannot be identified easily from the air by other visual aid. It is located on airport high enough so that the beam clear all obstruction. It is usually provided with the 2 500 watt bulbs with a green color screen. It continuously flash a Morse code signal designating the airport. Next is a approach lighting. While approaching the runway for landing during night, the approach light are the only element of guidance to the pilot. The pilot generally decide whether to land or not when he is at a height of about 60 meters above the runway. Assuming that the cockpit cutoff angle is 15 degrees below the horizontal, the first light of approach that should be visible to him should be at least a distance of 900 meters from the threshold of the runway. The approach lighting system accepted by the ICAO is shown in the figure. The tower's bars, each 4.2 meter wide and located at 30 meter intervals along the extended center line of a runway, give a suitable information to the pilot of the angle of roll. At 300 meter from the threshold, a crossbar 300 meter wide is provided in white color, which serves as a distance marker. Circle guidance lighting. Circling guidance lights are provided when the existing approach and the runway lighting system do not satisfactorily permit identification of the runway and approach area to a circling aircraft. Yeah, see, I'm going to see it. Lighting, threshold light, so a green color, runway center line, runway edge lighting, so the pre-threshold wing bar. આ વચ્ચેની જે લાઇટો છે 28 સેન્ટર લાઇન બાર 30 મીટર સેન્ટર ટુ સેન્ટર વ્હાઇટ કલરની હોય, ક્રોસ બાર વ્હાઇટ કલરનો હોય, સિક્વન્સ ફ્લેશિંગ લાઇટ બ્લુઇશ વ્હાઇટ. ધ લાઇટ સિસ્ટમ હેલ્પ ધ પાયલટ ઇન ધ ફોલોઈંગ મેનર્સ. જોઈન ધ ડાઉન વિંગ લેગ ઓર અલાઇન એન્ડ એડજસ્ટ ધ એરક્રાફ્ટ ટ્રેક ટુ ધ રનવે એટ અ રિક્વાયર્ડ ડિસ્ટન્સ ફ્રોમ ઇટ એન્ડ ટુ ડિસ્ટિંગ્વિશ ધ થ્રેશોલ્ડ ઇન ધ પાસિંગ. Keeping inside the runway threshold and other features which will make it possible to judge the term on the base leg and the final approach. Circling guidance light should consist of lights indicating the extended center line of a runway, lights indicating the position of a runway threshold, and light indicating the direction of a runway. Next is a threshold lighting. Threshold lighting is illustrated in the figure. The identification of runway threshold has an important bearing on the pilot's decision whether to land or not. The terminating bar of LED lights placed 60 meters ahead of the runway threshold indicate the end of approach lighting. The threshold itself is lighted with a continuous line of green light extending across the entire width of a runway. Next is a runway lighting. Runway lights are placed along the full length of the runway in the two parallel straight lines equiset equidistant from the center line. They are placed along the edge or at a distance not greater than 4.5 meters from the edge. For a runway lighting, a more precise design commonly known as a narrow gauge pattern is almost universally used at the major airport. As the pilot crosses the threshold and is about to touch the runway, he finds the central area of the runway excessively dark, known as a black hole. The narrow gauge pattern is attempt towards lighting up the central portion of the runway. In this system, as shown in the figure, a group of high intensity lights are placed 118 meter apart and on either side of the center line of a runway. They continued up to 1140 meters from the threshold. Beyond this distance, closely spaced light are placed along the center line, which extend up to the other end of the runway. All the lights on the runway edges are elevated type, and those inside the runway are flush type. Threshold light green, and એમની જે છે narrow gauge lighting, flush grid white lights, elevated runway edge lights, and a center line runway flush white lighting systems. So આ એમની આખી એક lighting systems available હોય છે. Taxiway lighting. The following design consideration apply to taxiway lighting. The taxiway should be clearly identified so that they cannot be confused with the runway. On the target portion, on the target tangent, sorry, on a tangent position, the light are placed not more than 60 meters apart at a distance of 3 meters from either edge along the taxiway. The spacing is reduced on the curve and intersection to facilitate their clear identification. All the taxiway side lights are colored blue and usually project not more than 0.32 meter above the pavement surface. The center line lights are green in color and placed at 6 to 7.5 meter distance along the straight length and 3 to 3.6 meter distance along the curves. So the taxiway lighting layout, is lighting with uniform spacing not at 660 meter. Taxiway entrance exit sign, runway edge light, runway edge lights white, apron and hangar lighting. Flood lights are provided in this area. This light source is so mounted that it does not cause a glare in the eye of the pilot, the service personnel or the passenger. Normally, flood lights are mounted at least 12 meters above the pavement. Last is a stopway light. This may be provided to indicate the following to the pilot. Taking off toward the stopway, to extend the extent of a stopway area available to him. The stopway lighting arrangement should be fixed red light. Stop bars shall consist of light space at intervals of 3 meters across the taxiway showing red in the intended direction of approach. Okay, so અહીંયા આપણો આ જે ચેપ્ટર છે પૂરું થાય છે અને એરપોર્ટ નો આખો જે સિલેબસ છે અહીંયા આપણો કમ્પ્લીટ થાય છે. So if you have any doubt or any topic, so just drop a message and we will clear your doubt on that particular topic. Okay, so thank you so much.